Welcome to the National Museum of Australia. My name is Janda Gooding and I'm the Deputy Director of Collections and Content here at the Museum. Just before we commence the more formal part of the proceedings, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of this land on which we meet tonight, the Ngunnawal and the Ngambri peoples, and I pay my respects to their elders past and present. Well, welcome also to the first of a series of panel discussions organised by Radio National and the National Museum of Australia to discuss the National Museum's project, Defining Moments in Australian History. Defining Moments will be the centrepiece of the museum's work for the next 2 years. So we thank Paul Barclay and the Radio National for being so committed and enthusiastic in sharing this project with us. There will in fact be three more panel discussions about Defining Moments, so stay tuned, check our website if you want to sign up to our e-news and get more information about what's coming up on our program. It's also great to have such a sort of a good audience here tonight. But firstly, just let me introduce very briefly our panel members. Paul Barclay is the moderator tonight. George Megalogenis, Michelle Arrow, Gideon Haig, and Jackie Huggins. The National Museum and ABC would like to thank the panellists for joining us tonight, and in particular for Michelle, who stepped in at very short notice. Tonight's discussion is moderated by Paul Barclay. The discussion and the questions that you might like to ask after he opens up for questions will be recorded and then broadcast on Monday night at 8 p.m. on Radio National. As this is the first of the Defining Moments panel discussions, tonight is all about exploring the wider themes around the project. What events might have shaped us as a nation? And what are the ones that might continue to define us? Before we get underway, though, the co-patron of Defining Moments, the Honourable Michael Kirby, has a short message of welcome. Michael Kirby, together with Michael Ball, raised the idea of a project around great moments in Australian history with the National Museum a few years ago. Their aim was to prompt a discussion, a national discussion, about Australian history. This concept led to the formation of an independent and external board of advisory board of historians, who in 2014 nominated their 100 moments for discussion. The museum's role in all of this is to foster that conversation across Australia. After the launch of the project just a year ago, not surprisingly, we've also had hundreds of suggestions from members of the public about events in Australia's history that are important to them. And we invite you or your friends to go on our website, make a comment, or suggest a moment that you think should be considered as one of the 100 defining moments. Mr. Kirby could not be here tonight, but wanted to welcome you all personally. So here is a short video address from the Honourable Michael Kirby.
I'm Michael Kirby, and I'm a patron of Defining Moments. I welcome you to this exposition of the history of Australia, the history of the Australian people. Too many people get by in their lives without really thinking about that subject, and the object of the Defining Moments project is to encourage us all to think about where we came from and thereby to understand where we are and perhaps have a glimpse of where we're going. The project originated in the mind of an Australian businessman, Michael Ball. He was a person who had spent his life in advertising and communication, and he was just the right person to stimulate a group of Australians to try to define the 100 most important moments in our history, those that helped to define us. Naturally, we sought the advice of some of the top historians in Australia. We asked Geoffrey Blainey. We sought the assistance of Marilyn Lake and John Hirst and other historians and citizens of different backgrounds. We consulted widely. We had to have prehistory and modern history. We had to have the Indigenous people and the settlers and their descendants. We had to have people from different parts of the world who have come to Australia. And we had to have the good and the bad in our history. Now, of course, there was a lot of difference about what should make up the list of the top 100. But that shouldn't concern us. We should rejoice in the fact that we are a democratic and sometimes a disputatious people. And the fact that there are differences is healthy. And the fact that we can have debates and that we can express our views quite strongly as to what is left out and what should be in, that's what's exciting about this project. We decided that we wouldn't concentrate only on physical things, and that we would concentrate in the medium by which most people today get their news, information, and controversial opinions, through the internet and through electronic and digital means. And so this is the Defining Moments project, and these are the defining moments which have been selected. But you don't have to agree with our selection, and you should engage your mind and your spirit and your heart in considering what we've left out and what should be put in.
Hello and welcome. It's terrific to be here at the National Museum of Australia. As you've heard, I'm Paul Barclay from ABC. RN, and this event is being recorded for my program Big Ideas. It'll be broadcast Monday night at 8 on RN and will be available for download and podcast slightly before that time, actually. As soon as it's put together, we'll put it out there for you to download. So friends, family, anyone who couldn't make it tonight, let them know about it. What are the moments that define us as a nation and a people, and how have these moments shaped who we are today? An initial list, as you've just heard, of 100 moments has been put together by a panel of eminent historians for the museum. It's a starting point for a national conversation not meant to be definitive. In fact, the list's omissions and inclusions have already generated some disagreement from some of the panellists, as you'll hear tonight. Is the 2004 free trade agreement with the United States, which is on the list, really that important? Or is the realignment of our national and economic interests with China, is that the genuinely defining moment for Australia in the 21st century? Should 1788 be regarded as a defining moment because it's the year Captain Arthur Phillip established a convict settlement at Sydney Cove, or is it a defining moment because it heralded the dispossession of the original inhabitants, the Indigenous Australians, of their land? There are plenty of arguments to be had, which is entirely the point of this list. As Michael Kirby said, if you don't like it, you're free to challenge it. And you can, of course, get on the Twitter sphere to do so. Get involved in the conversation both now and after this discussion, hashtag NMA moments and at RN Big Ideas if you want to whack them in your tweets. Tonight we're going to kick off the conversation by getting a sense of what our panel thinks, and we'll conclude with 15 minutes or so of your questions and comments. When it's time to come to you, please be as concise as you can be. That means we'll get better value out of that 15 minutes. The panel have been putting their thinking caps on. Let me introduce them to you. On my immediate left is George Megalogenis, author and journalist. His book, The Australian Moment, won the Prime Minister's Literary Award for Non-Fiction, as well as a Walkley. It was the basis for the ABC documentary Making Australia Great. He has just released yesterday, in fact, his new book, Australia's Second Chance, What Our History Tells Us About Our Future, which I'm sure he'll draw on tonight, and which, just quietly, will be on sale in the foyer later on. Next to George, Michelle Arrow is Associate Professor of Modern History at Macquarie University in Sydney, where she teaches and researches Australian history. She's the author of two books, Friday on Our Minds, Popular Culture in Australia, and Upstaged, Australian Women Playwrights in the Limelight at Last, both of which were nominated for prizes. She's currently working on a history of the 1970s in Australia, was co-winner of the New South Wales Premier's Multimedia History Prize for the RN radio documentary Public Intimacies, the 1974 Royal Commission on Human Relationships. Next to Michelle, we have Gideon Haig, who's been a journalist for almost 30 years. He's a prolific author who's written an astonishing 30 books and edited seven others. He's won so many awards for his writing that time prevents me from listing them all. Suffice to say, some of his recent winning titles include On Warn. That's cricketer Shane Warne, by the way, and it really begs the question, did that ball that Warney bowled to Mike Gathing constitute in the 1993 Ashes series a defining moment in Australia?
Did for Mike Gathing.
but I digress. His other books are The Office, Uncertain Corridors, Writing on Modern Cricket, End of the Road, The Deserted Newsroom, and countless others. And next to Gideon, we have Jackie Huggins, AM, an author, historian, and Aboriginal rights activist of the Bidjara in central Queensland and the Birriggubba Jarra in Jarrow in North Queensland peoples. She's the director of the Telstra Foundation, adjunct professor at the Australian National University's Australian Centre for Indigenous History. And Jackie's also author of Sister Girl and co-author with Rita Huggins of the critically acclaimed biography Auntie Rita. Please make our fantastic panel welcome.
Thank you.
So, Jackie, you were one of the historians charged with the task of helping to put together the, I suppose, founding 100 moments. How did you go about it?
Yes, I'm clutching my notes here very seriously.
It's a tough task, isn't it?
It was no mean feat, actually. In fact, I didn't have the pleasure of meeting Michael Kirby, because that's why I was very impressed in the first place to join, and Michael Ball, but I came onto the scene maybe in the two last meetings where the list was still rigid but not set, and amongst those wonderful other historians, we produced something that we thought maybe it's not the defining moments, definite list, if you get my drift. But one which could open up discussion and national debate, and it certainly has. We're hoping to, in fact, join the dots somewhere there. And of course, there are gaps. There are things that have been missing. I can tell you, really, Paul, that we really agonised, and you know, I had sleepless nights myself over some of the ones that got dropped, particularly Cathy Freeman and the Olympic Games. But I noticed this has been picked up in the Your List, which is the list out there that's going around, so that's rather nice. Look, we weren't particularly tasked with looking at our specialist area. It was one of a very democratic and a kind of measured and considered brain dump, amongst us. I was privy to be on the panel with another Indigenous historian, Professor John Maynard, which I felt quite comfortable about. John knows his stuff as well. So the process, I guess, was just in terms of what we had to weigh up in terms of those defining moments that we thought were defining moments. They were carefully considered and discussed. Obviously, some of the classics are not included there, and it was it's almost like a Where's Wally after reading your list. How did the nation change? What did we see as the true legacy?
and the true outstanding moment of that. And also we looked at, in terms of the longevity of that defining moment, did it actually stop there, you know, or did it actually change change society and go on for a number of years?
And also the defining moments are not necessarily moments that make us feel good about ourselves or our history. There's a few there, a broad few that I can pick up on. There's the Mile Creek Massacre, for example, that terrible stain in Australian history where a gang of settlers slaughtered a group of Aboriginal people. There's the enshrining of the White Australia policy. There is even the extinction of the Tasmanian tiger, all of which tell us something about the settling of Australia and the history of Australia that's not necessarily putting us in the best light.
Well, that's right. We had to look at the unpalatables of history because they are our history and we need to know them and we need to acknowledge that they existed, particularly, of course, the brutal history of my people in this country and I guess the continued trauma that exists because of colonisation for our people and how it's acted out in our society today. So certainly, you know, we looked at the good, the bad and the ugly. And I think also it was about those aha moments where, you know, that make us wake up, that make us look at ourselves and make us, for good or bad, feel this happened, surely that, surely we won't see a repeat of that, but we can move together. You know, we can move on with our history. But to acknowledge it, to understand it, to clearly know that it happened. And, you know, a lot of that stuff has been invisible up until recently. You know, history has always been written by the winners. However, you know, we're seeing a number of our Aboriginal historians write that history and retell those stories. So that's very encouraging.
So, George, migration is a cornerstone of the Australian story. With the exception of Australia's First Peoples, we are all either migrants or descended from them. You've pointed to the assisted passage of migrants from the UK in the 1830s and 40s as a defining moment. How so?
So this is not on the list, and in fact there's only two decades not represented on the list, the 1820s, when the first semblance of not representative government, but the governor lost the power of the autocrat. So Macquarie was the last of the governors who was established as an autocrat in Australia, and there was the beginnings of the movement to parliamentary democracy, which is the 1820s, a decade left off this list. And the other decade that's left off this list is the 1840s. Now, an economic historian looking at the full sweep of data will pick out the 1840s as the most extraordinary decade in Australia's development, because that was the decade our national income literally doubled because of the assisted passage wave and the wool boom. And pretty much every other society on the planet at the time had some version of an extended depression. So they were known as the Hungry 40s in Britain. There was a shocking famine in Ireland, which over the course of half a dozen to a dozen years saw 1 million people die and 2 million people emigrate. There was revolution across the continent in Europe in 1848. That decade was the standout decade for Australia when it marked itself as a country almost, as a settlement, almost separated from the global economy at the time. And it wasn't soon after, when gold was discovered, that we became the world's richest people. The first year that we were top of the global income ladder was 1852. So the thing I wanted to suggest is that we're actually missing the key thing that defines us as a prosperous migrant nation. And that's in the mid-1830s, following a decision in London, Governor Burke actively recruited for the first time migrants from Britain. Actively recruited shepherds and tradesmen and domestic servants. And the first boat wasn't, the first couple of boats were kind of to his satisfaction. The third one wasn't to his satisfaction. His dispatches tell us that he thought that there were too many loose women on that particular boat. His definition, not necessarily aligns with the facts, but that's how he viewed it. And after the first couple of assisted patches boats, which were essentially boats filled at London's end to what London thought was New South Wales's needs, suddenly became, and this is policy was adapted very, very quickly, to the colony being an active recruiter. And this is even before race cards are played in colonial politics on the gold fields and later with people like Park stopping the Chinese from landing. This was an active, a positive choice to decide the content of the immigration program. And the reason why I suggest it as a defining moment is you can't explain Australia today without looking at that particular period in our history, because the preceding 40-something years, close to 50 years of convict settlement, each year between 1788 and 1836, there were more convicts arriving than free settlers. It wasn't until the colonies decided to recruit, i.e. by paying the boat fare from Britain to Australia, that suddenly we took off as a prosperous migrant nation.
Well, perhaps that illustrates the difficulty of thinking of history as a succession of defining moments. Now, it's very difficult to reduce those kind of practices, those kind of evolutions to a series of single decisions. What we're talking about here is a couple of historical, very important historical phases.
I was actually thinking, how would you define the moment? Basically, pick the boat that Carolyn Chisholm came on. Because Carolyn Chisholm was part of that first assisted passage wave between the big ones, between 1838 and 1841. In fact, the people that came over those 4 years overtopped the existing population. In 4 years, you basically created a new Australia that literally overtopped the people that had been here the previous 50 years.
And then the 1850s came, and as you mentioned, the gold rushes. And I was reading your book, actually, last night, and it struck me just how profound an impact the gold rushes had. By 1854, Victoria had trebled in size as a result of the gold rushes. Its population was bigger at the time than California's and New South Wales.
And it was a late starter. So
and Melbourne, it became a sort of globally discussed city, didn't it, at the time?
Yeah. The most visited port in the entire globe in 1852 was Melbourne. As I said, that was also the year we became the world's richest people, measured by GDP per capita. And in fact, the most extraordinary thing, and I must admit I didn't know this until I looked it up, a lot of these events are actually covered in the 1850s. There's very, very precise discovery of gold, rebellion at Eureka, of course, first railway line open, secret ballot, 8-hour day. Invention of Aussie rules, very, very important, probably the most significant moment as it affects my identity as a Richmond supporter. But here's the thing about the 1840s. That period where it's essentially the first run-up in prosperity occurred, and it was distributed fairly equally. So I dug out some accounts, some contemporary accounts from the press in Britain. If you landed in Australia, you would, on arrival, be guaranteed a job that paid two or three times the going rate in Britain. And remember, these are the hungry 40s in Britain. No wonder we were such a people magnet in those days, even with the fares being paid. Of course, by the 1850s, people were paying their own way to come here. Yes. We'd already earned a reputation. I mean, the 1850s is probably the single most significant decade in Australia's development, because our particular model of democracy was forged not just in Eureka, because obviously the parallel developments in some of the other colonies. I mean, as I said, the list really starts to heat up by the time you get to the 1850s.
So what does separation mean in terms of that discussion? What does the rivalry between colonies mean to Australia's development?
That's at the point, because it all happened very, very quickly. So there's a guy called Earl Grey, who was colonial secretary. He was not that keen on giving the Australian colonies self-government. And whilst he was still the colonial secretary, he'd given it to the Canadians, quite happily given it to Canadians, but he had a particular chip on his shoulder. He thought we hadn't overcome our convict past. If he actually understood demography, he could have counted up the Australians that were living in the various colonies in the early 1850s and worked out that what remained of the convict population was a fraction of the total population, and that most of the people who had come here were from the middle classes, drawn from the middle classes of the world. So once you separate... Once they got, and they all got separation around the same time. New South Wales kind of had a form of self-government before the others. Once they got separated, depending on the composition of these settlements, so South Australia and sort of Port Phillip and then Victoria were free settlements, and they had a particular character. New South Wales, which is an older settlement, of course, tended to be a little more corrupt, a little more aggro. Queensland, which separated later in 1859, had a peculiar rhythm to it.
Still does have a peculiar rhythm to it.
That's your comment, not mine. No, I won't comment. I can talk about Victoria. But And it still fascinates because I've spent a lot of time rereading the record, and the list it just prompts me again how fast we went from nothing to the world's richest people.
Well, this is a really interesting point. I am going to bring Gideon in on this, but before I do, I think we need to make mention of the fact that immigration has been contested throughout Australia's history. It is contested all of the time. I mean, you've got these people at the moment, the Reclaim Australia mob, contesting it. Yet, as you, I think, clearly point out, there is a direct correlation between our prosperity and these periods of mass migration.
Periods of Australia's greatest prosperity. This is not just GDP growth, this is GDP per capita, this is standard of living, are associated with mass migration. And the flip side of that story is when the doors were closed, when we went to racial selection under white Australia and the tariff, and some of the follow-up consequences of white Australia in the 20s when it became the British Australia policy and we're imposing quotas on Italians and trying to keep the Greeks out and trying to keep the Maltese out. They are periods of profound economic underperformance. I know that sounds like a clunky way of putting it. Australia shot so far above the rest of the world when it was open. National income basically quadrupled between 1835 and 1891. Our nearest rival was America. Over that period, only doubled their national income. So no settlement had flown as high and as quick. But the period of white Australia, the first half century of white Australia, and you can carbon date white Australia about 1888 when the Chinese were stopped on the Afghan boat. For that next 50 years, Australia was the weakest economy on the planet. Even Japan was growing faster than us. Certainly every country in Europe grew faster than us. In fact, for the first 40 of that 50-year period, by about 31 at the bottom of the Depression, our national income was lower than it was at the peak of the boom in 1891.
Let me bring you in, Gideon.
Sure.
You also think that the fact that Australia has become this incredibly prosperous nation is something that indeed we take for granted, actually, but it is a key part of our story, and it is a key part of the defining moments within our story. Perhaps you can talk a bit to that.
Well, I did think when I looked through the history, what a remarkably continuous and harmonious and peaceful history it was. Relatively little to do with war, and it was actually good on this list. I didn't think that Australia's sort of martial traditions were over-emphasised. Few natural disasters, no revolutions, no civil war, no coups d'etat, no political purges, no kind of convulsive territorial disputes, no secessions, no plagues or famines or pestilences. I mean, some of that is luck, but it is an incredibly blessed record when you review it.
Frontier wars, though.
Frontier wars, difficult to distill to defining moments because it is a continuous process, and perhaps, you know, we have to return to that issue of definition before. I did start to look, and prosperity, I think, has not only been an improver of our material sense of well-being, but has also had a significant symbolic quotient in Australia. The idea of developing Australian resources, not just exploiting Australian resources, but developing at the same time, you know, providing the wealth for toil to go with the golden soil. And that George will probably talk about this later, the pronounced decline of Australia following the Depression of the 1890s. We have a longer depression than any other country elsewhere in the world because of the collapse of our commodity-based economy. And that leads to a sense of that Australia has to kind of take steps to take control of its own destiny, and actually has to, you know, it oversteps the mark, it puts the rest of the world at arm's length. One of the historical dates that I've always quite liked, and one that I've gone back to again and again, is that I think one of the formative dates in Australian history is the 24th of April, 1915. Not the 25th, the 24th, because it's the date of the pouring of the first steel ingot at BHP Newcastle. And that meant that for the next 75 years, we had a city that was kind of identified with this very muscular and masculine industry, but also this extremely complicated history where we turned our own raw materials into steel for our own uses. And I think that was an important industry, not only in terms of its contribution to economic well-being, but a sense of kind of national pride. I guess the other industry that has a similar symbolic quotient It's mentioned in the list here as the production of the first Holden car, the 48215. That actually is interesting because I think it's probably underestimated what a what an act of political courage that was from the Labor Party of that period, from Curtin and then Chifley, to override Labor's concerns about foreign domination and monopoly power, to back off from the idea of the car industry as a state-owned enterprise, which they did countenance during the Second World War, and to back Australia to make things. Mm. And I think it's one of the reasons why this this moment always appears on our lists, and we always see in our mind's eye that image of Chifley standing by the first Holden. I think the other moment, or the other, it's a phase more than a moment, and it does appear here as a kind of a moment, is that period in the second half of the 1950s where another act of political courage, I think John McEwen and his fellow apparatchiks in the Department of Trade lead the economic rapprochement with Japan. We sign the first trade agreement with them in 1957. We have another agreement with them in 1960. We abolish the embargo on the on iron ore. We go from an estimation of Japan as this formidable, depraved enemy that we'd been fighting little more than a decade earlier to them being our largest trading partner by the end of the 1960s. That is an extraordinary transformation. We also, of course, we absorb immigration from Europe, some of our former enemies there, Italy and Germany. We probably come to terms with the peace perhaps quicker than any other nation in the world.
Okay, enough of the serious economic stuff, Michelle. Let's talk about the middle part of last century. You've identified the introduction of television into Australia. 1956, for the Olympic... 56, is that right?
Yes, it was. Yeah. It was just before... It was introduced pretty much in time for the Olympics, so it was one of the first things that was broadcast on television. And I mean, I think one of the interesting things about the list is that it's inevitably going to have more public events than it is private events. You know, that there is that sense that defining moments are events that are governments do something, a piece of legislation is passed, all of that stuff. And of course, television had to have, there was a Royal Commission into television before it was introduced. There was great debate about whether television should be introduced to Australia or not. Menzies, I think, was very keen to kind of put it off. I don't think he was very keen to introduce TV at all. Yet there was a sense that Australia was lagging behind the rest of the world because there were many, many countries had television before Australia got it. But I think it's interesting that there is that kind of government process around the introduction of TV, but the introduction of television is something that really transforms individual lives, family life. I mean, there was a lot of discussion about what room in the house it should be in, where it should go, should you eat your dinner before you watch the TV or not. So I think in terms of its impact on everyday lives, I think television is one of those hugely significant defining moments. But again, I mean, when it was first introduced, most people watched it through a shop window. You know, there weren't people didn't have television.
But it was a disruptive technology, wasn't
totally
it?
Disruptive. I think it had enormous impacts for radio. It had enormous impacts for cinema. You know, a lot of cinemas closed. People were writing, you know, television killed me on the on the cinema doors when they closed down. It had enormous implications for things like sport. You know, suddenly broadcasting rights become much more important than gate takings for sport. And so that, again, has all kinds of flow
and we get to see ourselves reflected back at ourselves through this medium, don't
that's
we?
I
for
think
the for the first time really
exactly and I mean I think that's one of the most significant things. I mean, radio shows like Blue Hills were giving people a sense of what the Australian voice sounded like and Australian stories, but I think television, but particularly by the time you get to the 1970s and 80s where you get the golden age of serial drama, miniseries, that people were, it was the most effective medium for telling Australian stories, I think, back to people. And really now, I think, with the kind of idea of event television has sort of receded somewhat because people are downloading things and watching on demand. But I remember being a kid and watching those miniseries and everybody was watching them because that was it, you know, that was the moment where everybody got together. And so I think television provided something of a common language for Australians. And I think it's interesting that no television programs are on this list, you know, in some ways, because, I mean, obviously there's a defining moment and there's a defining moment, but I do think that there are kind of moments that we have experienced through television, like 9/11, for example.
Should we have colour television in there as well?
I think perhaps should we should, you know, bung in colour TV, perhaps.
Should we?
So Gough Whitlam dismissed in the year that colour television is introduced to Australia.
You know, put them together.
Jackie.
Yeah, I remember back in the day,
living in my where I grew up in Inala in Brisbane, and we used to have one of those televisions that you had to put the money in.
Oh, really?
No, I'm a bit, probably, gee, I'm older than anyone on the panel.
Pay TV.
Does anybody remember that? It was kind of like a pay TV. Some people do remember that in the audience because, and I remember every pension week, we'd watch a lot of television, but then the thing would just go zoot and it would just cut
Where did
out.
It go?
Yeah,
where did the money go?
It was just amazing. It went to the little man who collected it every fortnight, the television
did
machine,
he give you,
see?
But he gave you a return, like... Was it the milkman doing the run at the same time?
Something like that.
Well, you were saying, Michelle, that there are no television programs on the list, and I was wondering whether or not number 96 should be on the list. If I may be wrong, but is it not the first time that we see an openly gay character on the Australian character on the TV screen?
And in fact, Michael Kirby is on the box set of number 96 that has been produced, kind of talking about how important that was. I mean, it's interesting that we have... the Mardi Gras march is one of the events there.
Yeah. Mm.
And I think clearly that was a significant event. If it had only been a one-off, it wouldn't be on the list, but it's important because it's the first. So a lot of these things are firsts, which I think is interesting. Mm. But something like number 96 was important because it was, of course, it was a product of the sexual revolution as much as anything else, but it was significant because it had a gay character in it who was not a stereotype. He wasn't a Mr. Humphreys on Are You Being Served? And he wasn't a murderer or a kind of crazed character like a lot of the characters on Number 96 were. And so a lot of people in my research talked about how important that was to see a gay man on television that seemed someone like you. Mm. You know, so I think there's that other, the power of something like popular culture in that it can reflect changing realities and make people feel more, you know, comfortable and at home in their own skin, which I think is important. Mm.
Yeah, one recent moment that seemed defining to, I'm assuming, many of us in the room was the national apology to the Stolen Generations, Jackie. It had real symbolic power, as do many of the moments actually on the list. They have symbolic power, but with the national apology, you don't have to look very far to find people who are disappointed with the follow-up to that apology. And it does make me wonder, are symbols important as defining moments, or should we be looking for the substance behind the symbols?
Great question. I would probably go for the substance behind that. And as I said before, just in terms of longevity of that defining moment and where it has taken us. For instance, with the national apology, Kevin Rudd, the then Prime Minister, of course, put in place a close the gap measures for measurements for Indigenous people and departments that were responsible, other service providers. But mostly it was around the COAG agreements and the departments that were responsible for the social well-being of Aboriginal people. Not only that, but incarceration rates, etc., etc. Sadly, we saw the last Close the Gap report, quite dismal, in fact.
It's an annual report card, really,
isn't it? It's an annual report card,
and it's just bleak most years, it has to be said.
Yes, it's just showing, you know, in many respects we're going backwards rather than going forwards. And I mean, it's just one of those incredible times. The apology, I was sitting in the gallery, I remember it firsthand, and just the euphoria of people in our nation. Yeah, much like the bridge walks in 2000, the euphoria that our people said, you know what, I didn't think white fellas cared this much about us or would come and support us and join us. But still, it doesn't deny that we're still plagued with those horrible social ills that we still have within our communities, high incarceration rates, children not being educated, the health statistics, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So there is still a festering sore, I think, in terms of these defining moments, but what they have meant or where they have led. I'm not saying it's all gloom and doom, because it's not. I mean, there have been some brilliant outcomes. We see, you know, about 150 of our own doctors. We have lawyers. We have engineers. I mean, I taught a young fellow that wanted to be our first Aboriginal astronaut at the University of Queensland. So these things are changing, but still we're still very much plagued with a whole range of social ills that we should have tackled by now.
One of the things that's interesting on the list, the list of 100 that we're sort of agreeing and disagreeing with, is the activity in the 60s and 70s around Indigenous issues and Indigenous affairs. We have the Wavehill walk-off of Aboriginal cattlemen from the Vestey's cattle station, led by Vincent Nagyari in 1966. A very big moment, because not only were they protesting against poor wages and conditions, but this was to morph into the Aboriginal land rights movement.
Yes.
We then had, in 67, the referendum and the incredible support it drew. And if you know much about the failure rate of Australian referenda, you know just how significant that victory was. You then have in 72 the Tent Embassy set up, and in 76 finally Fraser making good on Whitlam's promise for national land rights. It seems like a period where a lot's happening, and a lot actually positive is happening in that time.
Yeah, it was a really little hotspot, that that period. And, of course, we were very much influenced by what was happening in the civil rights movement over in the States, then the women's movement as well, in terms of, you know, we were in globalisation then, even though I didn't even know what globalisation was until, you know, my 40s, I think. But we were actually, you know, these events overseas were, in fact, defining what we could be and what was possible in our own country. So very much that timing, I was quite a young woman then, a young girl actually. And in terms of seeing that, you know, sometimes I get a bit anxious when people say, well, nothing's changed for us. But it has, you know. It may be in glacial places, but things have changed since these times. But they were great. They were great times. I can't remember it as an adult, but certainly as a young child, it was all around me. Mm. I was surrounded by it, and you can't help but be informed by that or grow with that.
Yeah. Jackie, and Gideon alluded to this earlier, the interesting thing about that period, when you do set it against what was happening in the United States, even though technically we followed them, we didn't do it their way.
No.
So, you know, the Freedom Riders weren't getting...
Yes.
Shot by rednecks.
No.
You weren't getting state troopers mowing down peaceful protesters as they approached the state assembly. You didn't have the beginnings of an undeclared civil war between black and white.
No.
You had something else. You had Australians going, not only is this a big idea and a good idea, we're gonna overwhelm you with a big yes. And what I didn't realise, because I've only just started reading up. Megan Davis has just written a book on constitutional recognition. Yes. What I didn't realise was that this wasn't the top of mind issue for Harold Holt in that referendum. When the vote came in at 90%, he was more worried about the second question, which didn't pass, which was the relative position between the House of Reps and the Senate.
That's right. Yeah.
So he was worried about the game of politics. And there's a big 90% yes vote, and there's very little reporting of it in the Prime Ministerial response to it. I had no idea about that.
Yes, but
Well, because no one offered a no question. Case in 67 on that case. So
and they assumed it wasn't controversial.
Yeah, so perhaps there was... I mean, there was enormous goodwill, I think, around that, and we were talking about this before, partly because I think there was a sort of sense of we are voting to give Aboriginal people equal rights, and, of course, that wasn't quite precisely what the question was, but the way Fakatsi, the organisation that campaigned and organised the Yes case, very much emphasised that, and I think it's remembered in hindsight in slightly misleading ways. Oh, it's the, you know, when Aboriginal people got the vote and all of that kind of stuff. So we tend to, I think, remember some of these events quite differently. But that's interesting that Holt was.
He was fretting about what he did, the referendum question didn't get up.
And just a bit like the, it's a little bit like the We Look to America. Article that Curtin wrote, which seems to have been written by his press secretary and sort of slipped into the Herald on a slow news day, and has since been remembered as, you know, this transformational moment in Australian history where we change our perspective from looking to Britain to looking to the US, and it's all really condensed to a single phrase. But in fact, you know, John Curtin was as capable of being a toadying Anglophile as Robert Menzies.
I suppose bringing together some of these Indigenous issues and statements with our national obsession being sport, and thinking and coming back really to the point that Jackie made earlier, the moment that I don't think made it into the final list of Cathy Freeman winning the gold medal at the Sydney Olympic Games. Once again, one of those things as a sports fan, as an Australian generally, it felt like a huge moment on the Olympic track, a rare gold medal by an Indigenous Australian, happening at a time when we were struggling with this issue of reconciliation. I loved that moment. But then at the end of the day, Gideon, you say, she won a race and it's a sport. How do we evaluate its actual significance?
I've always liked that line of Greg Dennings, who said that nothing is so fleeting as sporting achievement and nothing so lasting as the recollection of it. Because it does come down to moments, doesn't it?
Yep.
It's often illusory, but you do seem to be able to see the trajectory of history changing in the stroke of a bat.
It felt so big
at
that moment, didn't it, Jackie?
It did. Yeah. It was a moment in our history, of course, when the world stopped. I mean, I travelled overseas and everyone said to me, the Indigenous people said, she not only ran for you, but she ran for us. Mm. So, you know, this sort of theme and concept of globalisation.
That sense that she had
again,
this nation on her shoulders.
Yeah,
the pressure on her is unimaginable. Mm-hmm. And on this one night, this perfect night, mm-hmm. in our perfect city at this moment where the whole world is watching, she mm-hmm. wins. It's like a perfect moment.
Mm. And I think it's also one of those moments in hindsight that, I mean, at the time, I mean, I think the Olympics, the Sydney Olympics, were not an event I would put on this list.
Yep.
I think Cathy Freeman's race was, as you delve into it, it's because of the moment of the refusal to apologise by John Howard, the reconciliation mm-hmm. movement, all those things, that sense of expectation that was fulfilled, that she managed to kind of pull it off, which I think was, incredibly special. And I think it's one of those things where I think it appears on the people's list, of moments. Yes. It doesn't appear on the official list. So I think,
I have to confess that I was at the supermarket when she won. Because I thought, well, it'd be nice and quiet.
Gideon.
I think everybody was, down at the Sydney Harbour.
It would have been a very empty supermarket, Gideon.
I hate shopping.
Actually, just because Jackie was privy to this discussion. Yeah. So if you think about what the sporting moments selected tell us, the 20th and the 21st century sporting moments that were selected, there's none in the 21st century. So we've got body line because that sort of plays to our victimhood.
Yeah.
In the middle of the Depression. Mm. And the fact that we didn't riot, which is the subtext.
Yes.
Mm. No one jumped the fence.
Yeah. Mm. You put Neymeyer in there, couldn't you, with body line?
Yeah.
The tensions between England and Australia at the time.
Yeah. Mm. So say the Germans had played the Greeks, because Neymeyer and the Premier's plan was the equivalent of the Greek austerity package that's been imposed by Europe today. Yeah. So the Germans are playing Greeks in soccer and they go the biff in Athens. Would they have not jumped the fence? They probably would. But Australians, for whatever reason, didn't jump the fence in 32-33 because it does play to our victimhood. Mm-hmm. But you don't have Cathy Freeman on the list, which is achievement.
It is.
Anyway, so that's the dichotomy for me. If you're going to have a sporting event,
I guess why
101 defining moments.
Yeah. Well, I guess why we chose the walk over the Sydney Harbour Bridge, the reconciliation walks, is that it was a start of something really big in this country. In fact, the people who walked over the Sydney Harbour Bridge were bigger than the Vietnam moratorium marches in this country. It was the biggest march in this country. People don't know that, around the country, of course, there were a million people that marched. So what did this say? What did it say to our people? What did it say to Australians? We were definitely united in that moment, as we were with Cathy Freeman, as we were quite clearly. However, this had a bit of a longer road to run, pardon the pun, in terms of what could we actually get out of this. This was an incredible time. With Cathy, great, she won the race, we're all very proud, but did that see what did that see for us? Mm. You know, did it change anything? Were there partnerships formed? Perhaps yes. Mm. But around corporates, sponsoring bodies, whatever. So I guess that's why we went with the walks and the longevity of that.
So did you see it as an either or between that? Given that you were talking about the same year, so that was the either or.
Yeah, I wish we could have both got them in, but we were heading towards that, you know, that 100, the golden 100. I don't know why we couldn't get over. But it should have been 105, I reckon, or something, or 102.
But it does come back to this thing about how you define what a defining moment is, and how do you find a moment that accompanies an important change or revolution in society. And so, Michelle, I was in that context trying to think of the second wave of feminism and women's liberation and the moment at which we can say something changed in that regard. And I suppose you could have brought up the publication of the female eunuch, maybe.
I was just thinking about that,
But the list has got the oral contraceptive being introduced in 1961, the ability of women all of a sudden to have better control over their own fertility, which I imagine then leads more women to join the workforce and opens up the contemporary contribution that women now make to society.
Exactly. And I mean, I think the other event that is there is the equal pay decision, you know, which again, I think is, you know, I mean, if you think about the contraceptive pill gives more women control over their fertility, you've got more women entering the part-time workforce, partly, I think, as a result of having a lot of, you know, perhaps increases in household debt, but also more women wanting to get back into the workforce. So I think you have that sense that the pill unlocks a whole lot of things. And it's while it's not necessarily a defining event in itself, I think the repercussions that it has are quite considerable because women start to go into the workforce or wanting to go into the workforce. Childcare is very difficult to get. Other issues that come up around equal pay, and they're the kind of issues that bubble to the surface by the end of the 1960s. And and you know, as Jackie was pointing out with the Indigenous movement, the kind of influence of American literature and British literature, British ideas about women's liberation. I heard a couple of very long-standing women's liberationists talking yesterday, and they were saying Germaine Greer's The Female Eunuch was great because it was a work of popular feminism, but we sort of already knew what she was saying. But I think The Female Eunuch, you could have put that on there because it is the moment where, I mean, that's the book that every man talks about getting hit over the head with, you know, some woman reading it going, you're a terrible husband.
It's also one of those books that's referenced continually by people you suspect never read the book in the first place.
That's exactly right. But I think the women who did read it, you know, you certainly hear a lot of women who did read it and talk about it as being a kind of, you know, life-shaping moment. Mm. And I think, again, that's that question around the public and the private. I think what's really interesting in this list, you know, is that I mean, there was one famous historian who said there was no Renaissance for women. You know, you kind of talk about the kind of how an event is understood publicly, how an age, historical epoch is understood publicly. But for many people, their lives don't change. They're not shaped by these moments.
As a companion to that one historical episode that interests me, because I've written a book about it, is the Menhinnett ruling.
Yes,
for the exactly. Which clarified the circumstances under which a woman could have a lawful abortion in Victoria. And it wasn't even reported in the following day's paper. It was just a ruling, common law ruling, given by a judge in the course of a case involving the prosecution of a man who'd been arrested for abortion. Yeah. And it happens almost out of sight, out of mind. And at a time where really circumstances couldn't have changed any other way. Mm. Because at the time, Henry Bolte ruled Victoria with the help of DLP preferences, so he was quite heavily enmeshed with Catholic politics. It was very difficult for a politician to do anything under those circumstances. It required a bit of judicial activism. Mm. This very improbable judicial activist, Cliff Menhinnett, who was a trade practices lawyer by background, gave a ruling that continued to serve women in Victoria until they changed the law back in 2008.
It still is difficult, Gideon. In Queensland, abortion remains in the criminal code.
Yes.
And under a left-wing feminist Labor premier, two kids were charged with procuring an illegal abortion. And if it wasn't for an eminently sensible jury who actually, probably by the letter of the law, should have found them guilty, instead said, this is ludicrous. Mm. If it wasn't for them, these two teenage kids from Cairns would have gone to jail several years ago. Mm. So anyway, that's now and not then. I want to stay in the sort of more contemporary past, and the Lindy Chamberlain case was something that you mentioned to me also, Michelle, as one of those moments.
Yes.
Talk a bit about that. I was at high school at the time. I can remember it was something that preoccupied all of us. The one thing I remember about it is that almost everybody in my outer suburban Melbourne high school believed she was guilty on the basis of virtually no evidence. That's my enduring memory of that time.
And I think that's probably the case with a lot of people, that's the memory. I mean, I think one of the things that's interesting about this list is that I kind of think there are sort of two ways you can talk about a defining moment. There's a formative moment. So women get the vote, you know, white women get the vote in 1902. That's a kind of formative moment because that creates all kinds of changes. And you also have these kind of extraordinary moments. They're either abnormal, they're traumatic events, they're bushfires. It's Cyclone Tracy, I noticed, is on the list. You know, you have these one-off events, the Bali bombings, you know, things that are highly memorable. Whether they're significant and what sort of impact they have is often, I think, I mean, you could look at Cyclone Tracy and say, well, that changed the way that buildings were built in Darwin, and so that does have a significant effect. But it also is this sort of cumulative trauma that it has in many lives. And I think Lindy Chamberlain and the disappearance of Azaria Chamberlain and the, you know, four, I think, inquests into her disappearance and death is one of those, probably the most, you know, extraordinary event. And I think it has a number of resonances. It has that kind of question around the place of white Australians in the landscape. I think it raised kind of really profound questions around, did we really belong here and how do we fit in this strange place? You know, how do we kind of make our sense at home in this place? I think it was something about the way that women were perceived. I mean, everybody made judgments about Lindy Chamberlain in much the way that I think people are still making judgments about people like Peter Credlin, because of the way she looked. You know, they didn't hear much from her, but there was certainly something about the way she looked, the way she spoke. She didn't cry when she was expected to
interesting
cry.
Interesting segue there.
Well, I thought it was just struck me that it's interesting about Peter Credlin. She's someone that we see but don't hear from much. And I think people made a lot of their judgments about her based on how
and
she looked.
And, of course, it is quite possibly, I can be corrected on this, the best known miscarriage of justice.
Yes, exactly. I mean, that's also what makes it so extraordinary. I mean, it made history in a number of ways. It was the first coronial inquest that was televised. The hearings were televised because there was so much discussion and debate about what had happened. I think it was a particularly low moment in the tabloid media. And if you've read Lindy's autobiography or have seen Evil Angels, that you'll see the way that the media kind of deliberately misled and set things up. It's also a really defining moment in terms of the misuse of forensic science. I mean, it was that sense where Lindy Chamberlain had a number of eyewitnesses who could all corroborate her story and believed her, but it was totally overwhelmed by this forensic evidence and this kind of sense that they didn't want to believe Lindy was innocent because of the way she behaved, but also because of this apparently overwhelming forensic evidence that turned out to be completely flawed. So I think it's one of those events that is a quite shameful moment in our past, because I think a lot of people had that experience of feeling, oh, yeah, she did it, and then having to reconsider that. And there are a lot of letters in the National Library of Australia where people wrote to Lindy Chamberlain and said, I thought you were guilty, but now I realise I was wrong and I'm terribly sorry about that. Again, it's one that comes up on the people's list. So I think, again, something about it's an event that we all remember from the recent past.
The secret ballot, Gideon, I think also makes it onto the list. Yes. But perhaps what people don't fully understand is it's one of the relatively few defining moments on the list that had an international impact, didn't it?
It's I think if you were to, you know, list the top five Australian innovations, the secret ballot would definitely have to be up there. It actually says that South Australia had the secret ballot. We had it first in Victoria.
Victoria had it first.
Correction.
Very interesting. Very interesting man created it. A fellow called Henry Samuel Chapman, who was a barrister and a bankrupt who's a friend of John Stuart Mill, founder of Montreal's first daily newspaper, compiler of Encyclopaedia Britannica's entry on wool and woolen manufacturers, and the Melbourne correspondent for the Times. Oh, wow. Fantastic. it was interesting because there were slightly different models of the secret ballot in Victoria and South Australia. South Australia's was slightly more sophisticated because the ballot papers weren't numbered. So you couldn't actually go back and find who'd made a particular vote. But it was interesting. I was first wakened to this when I read Catherine Helen Spencer's autobiography a few years ago, and she talked about going to the US for the first time in the 1890s. And she said that her reception in kind of reformist or radical circles was all about the ballot. People said to her, "You come from Australia, the home of the secret ballot." And she said, "That was the greeting I often received, and that was my passport to the heart of reformers all over America." Also found this fantastic novel, which was written in the early 1900s by a guy called Alfred Lewis, a book about Boss Tweed, the great impresario of Tammany Hall, because the Australian ballot, as it was called then, made it very difficult for party bosses, party machines to influence voting as they had in the past. And Boss Tweed is quoted in this novel as saying, "Gad, we must invent a gun that shall knock through this Australian armour. We must really. A beastly system, I should call it, which those beggarly Australians have constructed. It's no wonder they're all convicts down there, and it would need a felon to devise such an interference." Something we can all take pride in. The vexation of Americans like Boss Tweed.
So, George, what about the moment we became a nation? Federation. You touch on this in your book. Is federation a defining moment? Is it some of the events leading up to federation that are a defining moment?
I think you have to take federation a defining moment. But the question is, what do you mean by what became of that first federation parliament? So the most significant, and it's on the list, the most significant piece of legislation, the first significant, not the first piece of legislation, but the first significant piece of legislation, which was a declaration to the world of what this new nation of Australia stood for, was the White Australia Policy. Mm. Now, in that White Australia Policy and in those debates, the first seven Prime Ministers of Australia all had a go. Mm. And if you ever have a spare few minutes on the internet, get onto the Parliament House website and call up some of those debates and have a look at what Barton and Deakin and Reid and Watson and Fisher and Hughes. Just have a look at, and Cook, and have a look at what they all said about coloured people. Mm-hmm. And how important it was for Australia to maintain its Britishness, to maintain social cohesion. But of course, in the decades that followed, Australia was actually grumpier than it was when it was an open, globally connected settlement in the 19th century, mixing English and British and Irish and Welsh and Chinese and Americans and French and Germans. And so it is a defining moment, but it's a defining moment. These are the darkest chapters in our history, in our contemporary history. The absolute darkest chapters of our history are settlement and the frontier war. But of course, the flip side of even the dispossession is very quickly a very prosperous and cohesive nation was created at the expense. Mm. Yeah. Mm. So you're always going to have this particular dichotomy in Australia. So I think White Australia is something we need to refamiliarise ourselves with, not because we're going to go down that road again, but certain manifestations of White Australia you start to see again at the top of this particular boom, which is this urge to control, this urge to block the world off, this urge to issue demands to the rest of the world. You know, we won't do anything on climate change until you do. You know, we'll stop the boats, we won't take any refugees, although that position has changed from Syria. That belligerent Australia you recognise in history as the Australia that is sitting on a pile of cash and doesn't want to share it with anyone else.
Well, just on that, there is the 2001 Tampa, the Norwegian vessel which has rescued, over 400 mostly Afghan asylum seekers. It's taken over by Australian troops. They want to go to Christmas Island so that they can make a claim. Prime Minister Howard says they're never going to land on Australian soil. They get pushed off to Nauru. Felt like a significant event at the time and still feels like
a pretty significant
event.
And here's the... you've got to do the light and shade with these sorts of stories, of course. You can't just look at that and say, you know, start slashing your wrist and say we're irredeemably racist. John Howard discovered something really intriguing with the Tampa. Very soon after the Tampa, he started to ramp up the immigration program. And a lot of people that lived in electorates where they didn't have much contact with overseas-born Australians, who were still very, very anti-migration, thought because of the Tampa that John Howard wasn't letting anybody in at all. But it actually turned out that he'd supersized the migration program, and the people that started coming on John Howard's watch, and it's obviously now continued over the last three prime ministers, we're now on a fourth, since John Howard left, have pretty much led in numbers that even 20 and 30 years ago from China and from India would have been inconceivable. Could you imagine in 1988 or 1989 when John Howard first played the anti-Asian migration card that he would be the guy that essentially, you know, his co-legacy with Hawke and Keating is that there are 500,000 Chinese born in Australia at the moment, 400,000 Indian born in Australia, that people from Asia now outnumber people from Britain, Ireland, New Zealand and South Africa in Australia. And we are fast becoming the world's first genuine Eurasian nation and a high-income society to boot, and we're doing it with virtually nil disruption in the community.
Well, that brings us, we are running out of time, it brings us to China, and I think you've looked through the list
and can find
no mention of the word China in the whole list.
I would definitely junk a free trade agreement. And, of course, we'd also take Gideon's point that Victoria and South Australia
are the secret ballot. Whitlam went to China. Is there a moment when we can say that Australia left behind its history for its geography in China?
I think, actually, thematically, Whitlam went to China is probably not a bad one. It's a bit counterintuitive because it gets it before Whitlam becomes Prime Minister.
Yep.
It's an opportunity to start the conversation.
The people's list. Is it on the people's list?
It would have to be on the people's list. The other thing is, and we did allude to this earlier, when Japan overtook Britain as our number one trading partner in the late 60s, of course, China has now overtaken Japan. You might just sort of mechanically record the year, but the China boom began in terms of when cash started raining upon Australia in about 2003, 2004. But it might be, you might even think of something more symbolic when Hu Jintao addressed the Parliament. So you might take something as simple as that. You'd think, who would have thought, even 20 years earlier, the leader of communist China would be getting a standing ovation from Australian politicians? I mean, this is a big thing. This is not a small thing. And it is interesting that we sort of still cling to some of these other things. Obviously, we're now totally decoupled from the United States, economically so. When they're recovering and China's having a bit of a slowdown, of course, we're worse off. So, anyway.
Jackie, is there an event in Australian Indigenous history? Is there a moment? Is there something that you feel particularly like for you is a really ultra-defining moment? I must admit, I was going to ask this question earlier about whether we know a defining moment when we see one, and I felt like Mabo was that moment when we knew that the highest court in the land was prepared to say that there is a new form of land tenure in Australia, and it is a form of tenure that acknowledges ongoing relationship to land. That felt like...
Yeah, and it debunked the myth
of terra nullius
in this country, that we were actually here. There were living people in Australia. It wasn't an empty land. So, yes, I think that definitely changed the course of history. In my lifetime, I just think how magnificent, you know, it's been to see in the last 60 years, you know, the apology, the those walks, you know, the 1967 referendum, you know, just magnificent moments for us and defining moments. But Mabo, if you look at it in a kind of a historical sense, as a historical marker in this country, that would be it, definitely for me. Yes, Mabo.
And Michelle, you're writing a book on the 70s at the moment, I understand.
Yes.
researching that. Any moments from that gloriously multi-coloured era that we haven't touched on that deserve mention?
I mean, there are so many, and I think, you know, possibly the election of the Whitlam government could be one, because I think one of the things that it's, again, not necessarily because it was... I mean, it was important, but I think it kind of unleashed a whole lot of things that had been brewing for a while. And you see in that 3 years of activity by the Whitlam government, a whole bunch of stuff in relation to various social movements, which I think was long overdue. And I think
did the 60s get to Australia in the
70s? In the 70s, I think they did. That's my thesis, perhaps. Right, you know, okay. But you know, I mean, I think that's not an original. That's certainly not my. I didn't come up with that. I think certainly by the time you get to Whitlam, everyone's champing at the bit. Aboriginal rights, women's rights, gay and lesbian activism, the push for migrants to actually feel more part of the national conversation. I mean, we have multiculturalism as a kind of policy objective, which is mostly, of course, implemented by the Fraser government, and we have SBS as one of the moments on the list. But I think certainly that kind of the frenzied nature of that kind of period. But then, of course, the dismissal, which is also on that list, which, again, I think is an event that people remember. The taxi driver who drove me here was telling me he was there that day. You know, so I think that as a kind of significant moment in Australian political life and as the end of that dream for a whole range of reasons, I think it's also significant.
Yes, it was the moment at which many people thought there was the inexorable move toward Australia cutting the ties from England and becoming a republic.
I can remember being there. I was a primary school student, and I remember we were lined up at afternoon play to go back in, to march in into our classroom. And I can remember the headmaster coming out and telling us that the Whitlam government had been dismissed. And I can remember not knowing exactly what that meant, but knowing somehow it was important, that it was a defining moment. I thought I must always remember where I am right now, because it might be useful if I'm ever asked on a panel to talk about Australia's defining moments.
Yes. I remember no one being able to sufficiently explain to me how it could happen, actually. There were the sort of the dumb questions you ask when you're a kid, like, who's able to sack the Prime Minister? Which, of course, ended up being quite profound questions that constitutional lawyers argue about to this day. Yeah. We're in the middle of the sort of centenary of the Great War at the moment, and there's all manner of discussion about that, and we've run quite a lot of it on big ideas, which is part of the reason I haven't brought it up now. But Gideon, of course, we are told that Australian national identity has been greatly forged by war, by not just Gallipoli, but by our participation in various wars.
Well, certainly the trauma of war, the very heavy per capita casualties that Australia suffered, the long cycle of remembrance after it. In some respects, you know, this is a continuation of it, but you know, Australia really spent the next 20 years in mourning for what it's lost, and of course, the enormous potential of that generation that didn't have a chance to influence history, that didn't have a chance to participate in more constructive defining moments than sacrificing themselves for the greater good. I must say, I'm not displeased that Australia's martial traditions aren't overestimated in this list. I sometimes think we make rather more of them than we need to. Someone was telling me last night that Australia spent $500 million on remembrance programs for the First World War. That seems to be getting things a little bit out of proportion.
It's also vastly more than any other combatant
nation
in World War
I. More than Britain,
I mean, much more. It's kind of extraordinary how much.
Okay, that is the point at which we're going to finish our panel discussion, but we do have, as I mentioned, some time for questions and comments from the audience. Of course, it's been a ridiculously simplistic journey through Australian history that we've had. It's been a bit of fun, and don't give us your righteous indignation about what we didn't talk about, because we all know, and I've got a list of it here that I didn't have time to get to. But look, it would be great to hear from you about questions and comments. We have a gentleman in the middle there who's put his hand up very quickly. Well done. Mm-hmm. We've got 15 minutes or so.
David Stevens from Honest History website. At the other end of the lake, there's an institution, the War Memorial, which says its slogan is, "Every nation has its story. This is our story," the story that the memorial tells. Do you think that slogan and the defining moments concept can ever be reconciled, or does it sort of run its own race forever and a day?
Who wants to go?
Oh, look, I mean, clearly it's the war memorial. That is the story that museum was originally set up to tell. So I think it's lovely that the National Museum is running a slightly parallel track, which does give, I think it's much more inclusive and open. But that said, I mean, a lot of people do draw immense interest in military history because it's actually family history. I think that we kind of maybe perhaps sometimes misread some of the kind of commemoration they're spending a lot of money on it this year. The federal government is spending a lot of money on it. But I think a lot of what appeals to people in military history is those personal connections. So I think perhaps we shouldn't necessarily read them as in opposition to one another, but I think that I love the sort of democratising impulse of this.
Interestingly,
of this
Jackie, Brendan Nelson has declined to include the Frontier Wars representation of them in the in his institution. Henry Reynolds has been, and many others, applying some pressure on him to do so.
Yes, I think Brendan, his preference is that they come here National Museum, which is food for thought. it's interesting because my grandfather fought in Belgium in World War One, and he was injured. He came home, and my father was a prisoner of war in World War Two, a prisoner of war at the Burma-Thailand Railway. He lived to the age of 37 and passed away from the post-traumatic stress kind of thing. So, you know, it is about the stories. It is about that the military history, and every Indigenous person in this country would have an ancestor who went to war, or sometimes when we weren't even citizens of our own country. So, you know, it's something that we have to, you know, kind of recognise ourselves. Yeah.
And perhaps thinking of it as separate is actually not the, you know, I mean, Indigenous history is totally intertwined.
Yes, right through.
Mm. Okay, let's keep racing through. I think there was a gentleman there and then there and maybe there as well.
Just one observation. When you look at the people's list, there seems to be more social defining moments than traditional history moments, which I think is very interesting, and you actually seem to spend more time on talking about things on the people's list than the other list. But I wanted to ask, if you could create a future defining moment for Australia, what would it be?
In a word, republic, because it's going to happen eventually.
Well, yes.
So,
I'm absolutely.
Treaty?
Like treaty?
You know?
I don't know if you could sort of Cathy Freeman running Far Left Along the Shores of Gallipoli, couldn't she? Throwing a ball to Donald Bradman.
Yeah. Shane Warne. Yeah.
Just a giant fish up.
Yeah.
Just to kind of bring it all together.
Some new beer being invented or something.
Yeah. Yeah. I can't think.
Maybe that's the challenge for the museum. Maybe we get a competition there in that very question, actually. Okay.
Thank you. The panel seems to be entirely urban-centric. May I say that there are some fine rural defining moments. We can talk about rabbits, the introduction of
snakes.
We can talk about our hero, Frank Fenner, and eczematosis. We can talk about bush flies and Doug Waterhouse, another Canberra hero. We can think about the 51 wool boom, 150 million sheep we had. And it was such a strong part of our whole economy. And then, after the Korean War, which of course assisted the wool boom, the introduction of synthetic clothing and what an impact that had on rural industries. And the panel might like to discuss the freedoms that we've had, perhaps, or the wins, such as the cessation of London funds and the introduction of the High Court.
Well, there's a raft of very good points that you've made there. Gideon, were you going to comment?
I did think that wool was underrepresented in our list, partly because it was everyone's perception of Australia, that we were the wool country. You know, everyone knew, if they knew anything about Australia at all, it was full of sheep. And I think part of our, perhaps overall, our defining moments haven't given enough consideration to how we've been perceived externally.
And that was actually my point about the 1840s. Because what was the global income stream that was bringing the migrants? It's because the colonies went from, you know, a fraction of Britain's wool supply to majority supplier by the end of the 1840s. Replaced Germany as the number one supplier of wool to Britain. And that story, it's a rural story, but it's also part of the Industrial Revolution. and our part in a global system.
It also perhaps relates to there aren't that many, I think, milestones or moments here around mining too. So, I mean, I think that it's probably a list that's very much, it's like any history, it's always written from the present perspective, and we are today a very highly urban society. So I think we do tend to downplay the importance of the rural and the regional in these kinds of lists too.
Yeah, one thing I actually wanted to get in the list was the introduction of the dung beetle to Australia in the late 1960s by the CSIRO to counteract the bushflies, which were in plague proportions, of course, because cattle were an introduced species to Australia. I don't know whether it's just an impression that I had, but when I was a kid, I remember there being lots and lots of flies in Australia. There don't seem to be anywhere nearly so many flies now, which, of course, has conduced to us leading a much more pleasant outdoor lifestyle when we get the opportunity to sit in our cafe dining al fresco. you kind of think maybe 30 years ago that wouldn't have been possible. I don't know, though, maybe that's just an impression that I've got. You won't be able to see that on radio.
The Broken Hill ore deposit too, we didn't talk about in the 1880s, which was a pretty big deal, wasn't it? Thanks. Oh, we've got a funny mic, have we?
Okay.
How we were so isolated
before
that went down. Mm. And now I'm a bit regretting it, especially since I saw the towers coming down in Sandra Sully right on the spot before even the New Yorkers knew what was happening. But I think that was a big time as well. Plus altruism and volunteering. The surf lifesavers, the flying doctor service, teaching English to migrants. And so there's still a lot of sort of isolation which volunteers overcome.
A Twin Towers moment really wasn't our moment as Australians, like exclusively, but it was a moment. I was doing one of these events actually in Townsville that night, and we all retired back to the bar and the casino, and the rest of the gang stayed up and saw it all unfold live. I went to bed and remember getting the phone call telling me to get up and watch it. It was one of those, as you say, the coaxial cable bringing you that horrific event, interrupting your life. They haven't spoken a lot about science and technology either.
The internet, I think, appears on here at one, and again, that reminds me too of the sort of decreasing isolation, the globalisation, and I think Gideon, you touched on this, that these are very much about how the nation is perceived from without, you know, that these are very much a national list, and so I think things like globalisation, the coaxial cable, all those things are bringing the world closer.
The introduction
together
of a telegraphic cable from the UK in the 1870s is a phenomenal shrinking of time and space. You know, recently I've been looking at reporting of cricket from overseas. And it fascinated me that Australian papers were actually able to carry scores of that amazing game where the Australians beat MCC at Lord's in 1878, virtually 12 hours after it happened. They could only get in like two paragraphs, but what an amazing two paragraphs it was. The Australians have bowled out the MCC for 33 and 19 and beaten them in a day. I mean, can you imagine what it must have been like to pick up a copy of the Argus and read that? There just would have been a sense of complete disbelief about this. And that was something that had only really been possible for the preceding 3 or 4 years. And then there's the case, the opposite case, where England coming out here for the first five test series in 1894-5, they begin to publish full-scale reports of that series in the Pall Mall Gazette. Very, very expensive expedient because the cost per word was so high. But it meant that sport was suddenly, you could follow sport almost in real time on both sides of the world. And, you know, it was alleged that Queen Victoria followed that series really closely, that the stock exchanges closed. There was a sense of, and because cricket is the first game, the first kind of national game in both these countries, it has a tremendous, tremendous traction, which in some respects it's never really lost.
Mm. Yeah, colour TV became important with sport too, didn't it? Because all of a sudden you could see cricket in its full glory, and football for that matter too, actually.
Well, yes, and of course Kerry Packer takes advantage of that by bringing colour to cricket to meet television halfway. If there was probably another sporting incident that I would have included on the list of 100, it would have been that fabled game at the SCG on the 27th of November 1978, where World Series cricket comes to the SCG and kind of crashes the establishment's party and in a sense becomes the new establishment going forward.
Mm. One more question I reckon we've got time for. I've got no idea who to pick out of all that group of hands that just went up there. So we'll take the woman
at the back
with the blonde hair.
Hi, my name's Laura, and I'm a recent science graduate from the Australian National University. And I'm too young to remember the vast majority of the events on that list. There's a lot of them, like the Chamberlain case and the 67 referendum, that bring up emotions for me and that in some way I do remember. And so I guess I wanted to ask you guys, in making that list, how does that collective social memory play a role in making a defining moment?
That's an excellent question.
It's a very good question.
It's an excellent question.
It's really about memory, isn't it?
Yes.
But some of the memory you're describing is a repetition. It's the replay.
Yes.
Yeah.
And also, interestingly enough, a lot of the... I mean, we talked about how, in some ways, there are certain decades that aren't represented and they're mostly well out of the realm of living memory. So I think it's interesting that looking at the people's list, there are a lot of events from the recent, you know, within living memory, I think, too, and things that... are important not necessarily because they were... like things like the America's Cup. I mean, I remember that. I wouldn't necessarily call it a defining moment if I was going to be objective about the history of the nation, but I remember getting up and watching it with my dad and being incredibly excited and everyone was at school talking about it. So I think there's a really interesting interplay between public and private memory going on here and that, you know, that these are inevitably produced both by sort of official imperatives, you know, the sort of sense of what's... objectively important and what's remembered. And in 20 years' time, I suspect some of those events won't appear because they will have just, you know, I think something like the flight MH17 being shot down over the Ukraine, like clearly that's an important global media event. Will we think it's a defining event for Australia in 10 years' time?
Maybe not. And before I hand back to Janda to formally close tonight's proceedings, I want to remind you that there will be future events presented by RN and the museum. I'll be moderating them. We'll be taking some of the moments that we've spoken about tonight and drilling down in far greater detail around some of them, yet to be decided, I think, but where we really pull apart some of these moments in detail.
Thanks, Paul, and thank you everyone for coming tonight, and I thank our panellists. It's been an absolutely fascinating discussion. As Paul says, watch our website. We've got more of these panel discussions coming up next year. And the date for the discussion around Encounters, which is our very important Indigenous exhibition that opens on the 27th of November, the date for that Big Ideas discussion here is the 1st of December. So let's all thank the panel for tonight.